Okay, Dipali, what was this question that you were asking?
I am asking about what is the water discipline system, how it flows, means from where the water is coming and what the process is going on, and each part, means valve, pump, what is the importance in this system? What they work in this?
And working.
Yeah.
Working of the system. Okay. So we will discuss about this aspect considering the water supply schemes of an urban area. Right? Fine. Generally, there are different components of any water supply system. In let us say we talk about urban, right? So first of all the water is fed from some source of raw water, right? We have bifurcations of these sources, whether that can be a surface source or subsurface source. Any other one? Processed source. I'm coming to it, what it is. Okay, under the surface source, we either have flowing or non-flowing. Okay, subsurface, we have deep water sources or shallow. Here we have desalination plants. Okay, desalination plants mean what? These are the plants which desalinize the saline water. I mean water from ocean. Okay, and the salt that water is containing, it is removed by following certain procedure. Apart from that, processed source may involve the STBs, as we know of, sewage treatment plants, where there is no water in a very closed system, where water enters once, is never moving away from the system. It keeps on rotating, right? If that sort of system is there, the source of water supply can be adopted in that way also. Right. We are not restricting here this methods to potable source of water only. Right now we are thinking of a multiple set of use of water. It can be used for drinking, it can be used for washing the clothes or utensils, it can be also used for washing the streets or roads. Right. It can also be used for gardening or plantation to maintain urban green areas. So, maybe firefighting is one of the purpose. So there are multiple type of use which we cannot fix at the time of defining the source. Right? The water will be used for the any of these of the purpose. Now when we are fixing a demand of the water, we at that time we need to fix that what kind of use actually is required to get into. Right? At that time we need to think about the quality of water, whether this water will be used for certain purpose or not. Right? Let us say, for example, if the sewage treatment plant is there and you are treating the water for making it, bringing it down to a reduced level of pollution, by which the treated water can be used for gardening or washing the streets or washing the utensils even. Right? But people might not like to drink that water or use that water in the cooking purposes. Right, so for that we may have some separate arrangement, but for apart from that cooking and drinking purpose, rest of the purpose can be served by means of this treated water. Right? So very first part is that to have the source of raw water, what is it, how it is working, how much quantity of water is available, that we need to determine. For that there is another term called yield. Annual. how much the source will be able to supply water in terms of quantity, million liters per year. That we need to make an investigation for, right? That term is called as what? Yield or capacity. Capacity of, let us say, flowing water. Let us say it's a river flowing or a stream flowing naturally. It contains certain amount of water along the flow. Now, how much water you can extract out of that? Say, for example, for a case of Vishwamitri River in Vadodara, will you be able to extract water out of it and supply it to the entire of the city? It is not going to be possible because it is not a perennial river. It is not carrying the amount of water required to satisfy the demand generated by the entire of the city's population, right? In case of Narmada River, it is well possible because the river is not only perennial, but abundant quantity of water is also flowing all the time, round the clock, entire of the year. So, what is the maximum water that can be extracted out of it? It is called yield of the source. Generally, it is in terms of million liters per year. For say, deep water or shallow water sources from the ground, we are extracting. Right, those are ground sources. Groundwater sources are extracted. Maybe it is a reservoir below the surface. Maybe confined aquifer or unconfined aquifer. There is a detailed classification for this. But at this point, we need to know that what is my source of raw water and what would be possible quantity that it will be allowing me to extract from the source. Okay, so this is part number one. Number two is then that how I am going to extract this source. So we have to think of intake structures. Number two is intake structure. So depending on the type of source that we are looking into, the intake structure is determined. We may have infiltration gallery, we may have radial wells, we may have infiltration wells, and so on. There is also a number of mechanisms available as far as the intake structure is determined. Now, depending on the source capacity or yield of the source, in connection with the demand that is we are going to address, we determine the size, shape, and other elements of this intake structure. Okay, this much amount of water is going to be utilized. So annual, this is the level of yield. Every day I will need this much amount of water. That also will be in million liters. That is MLD, million liters per day. Million liters per day. So considering all those capacities, we need to define and design each and every component of the system. That includes the diameter of pipeline as well. Pipeline that is taking water from raw or source water to the treatment plant or maybe within the wells itself. There is another substance, let us say, mediator element called jack wells. Now, these jack wells are allowing water to be entering into this structure of jack well. These infiltration walls or infiltration galleries directly are not supplying water to any place. The pumps that we need to install, those pumps are installed in a jack well. So these wells, maybe these wells are located within the riverbed itself, so where we cannot install any submersible pumps or go over there inside between the river bed and maintain it, right? So we simply put a well at the top, or maybe some indirect mechanisms are constructed. Let us say this is the riverbed and this is the level of river water. So there is a pipe connecting here, where the jack wells are yet excavated deeper on the bank of a river. Okay, so the water will be flowing from here to the jack well, wherein we have installed some pumps which are fetching the water from this way up and then to other further destinations, whatever are there. Right, so this is the second part of intact structure which we need to think of when we are thinking of establishing the water supply network for any of these areas. Now, as soon as this water is flowing away from these jackwells or maybe directly infiltration gallery, it enters into the WTP, water treatment plant. You have been knowing the components of this WTP, right? So, first of all, there is this component called raw water intake, wherein oxygen O2 is entering, right? So, most of the impurities, maybe organic impurities, are treated to some of the extent. Dissolved oxygen is merged. Dissolved oxygen levels are increased by allowing it to flow and come into the contact of the air. Right? So, natural oxygenation process is carried out in here. At the same time, this intake will be going to a screener, screen chamber. Now, screen chamber, here we can add chlorine, the first dosage of chlorine. Right, and the screen chamber will be taking care about the floating materials. Any of such debris or wrappers of plastics or maybe small parts, maybe leaves of the tree or that sort of floating material can be removed at this screen chamber. From there onward, it goes into the primary settling tank, secondary settling tank and clarifloculator and then filtration unit. Filtration unit also there are variety. Say for example, slow rate filter or rapid filtration process, right? So there are different mechanism and options worked out so far. So at the end of this treatment plant, what we get is certainly assured quality of water, wherein the level of the constituent or containing parameter, components, rather not components, but the quality of this water is brought down to the levels suggested by the authority. In our case, it is Gujarat Pollution Control Board, which is led by the government of Gujarat. But above it, there is another authority of Central Pollution Control Board, CPCB. So they have defined the norm that this is the level of dissolved oxygen, this is the level of turbidity, this is the level of this and that, and every other parameters, right? Even the metal, for metals, if in certain area, if metal is also merged into that, then metal level of these metals is also defined, that up to this extent, generally those are called in the units of ppm, that is parts per million, which is equivalent to mg per liter. 1 liter quantity, against that this much number of milligram. So 1 mg per 1 liter is 1 ppm. Okay, so that is the unit under which these measurements are done as far as quality of water is concerned. But at the same time, the inflow, treatment and outflow. From here onward, we treat this water in number of, the unit. The capacity of retention time T. We need to decide that by what time certain amount of water is entering into this my treatment plant, and at the end of certain duration, how much water should be coming out. That we need to determine. Now, this coming outgoing water or outflowing water is directly related to the demand. How much water I am supposed to supply per day, per household. Okay, so we are coming to this demand part. So this is the demand, and that much demand is generated per day. That means that much water must flow out of the treatment plant after the treatment is confirmed with the determined standards of quality. Okay, so we are not entering into the design of this WTP. That is purely a job of an environmentalist. They will decide that this much amount of quantity is required at the intake level. So accordingly, in the backflow, they will determine the yield. Based on yield, how much water is to be fetched every day. Okay, and accordingly, whatever designs are required, they take care of that component, right? So once the treatment is given, even before taking water out of this plant, super chlorination is done, which will take care of any bacteria, algae growth inside the system onward within the distribution network. So none of the diseases are spread, right? So that is called super chlorination. But at the same time, this GPCB, CPCB authority has given standard that at the user's end, or at the end where water is taken out from the system for further usage, the allowable limit of chlorine is this much. So that is known as residual chlorine. Right? So super chlorination is done mostly only in the cases when this season of monsoon is there. Apart from that, super chlorination is not required, because most of the time the additional or filter efficiency, all those terms will take care of normal level of these bacteria and organic compound that are present in the raw water itself. Right? So as soon as this step 3 of WTP is there completed, the next step or the system coming into the picture is the storage. Storage prior to supply. Okay, so as soon as we have this WTP, and when the WTP is supplying water per day, let us say 150 MLD supply from the WTP's capacity is being released, 150 million liters per day, right? So for that, we need to, before we start distribution among the users, we need to store the water for a certain duration. Okay, why is so? Because we are not allowing the water to flow 24/7. If it is the case, no problem. But the problem is because we have a very larger area to be covered, and that area is being served by, let us say, one ESR of that particular area with limited number of networking lines. These are the main lines. Then there are sub mains like this, covering most of the area, and from that sub mains we have another network of, what does that call? What is the next level of sub main? Branches, right? And from branch, next level is sub branch, consumer's end, right? So when, or maybe at certainly sub branches can take care for the individual households connections, no problem with that, right? So what happens is, as soon as we have this one line coming into this ESR, very much nearby there is another area of supply for another ESR with similar condition. Now what may happen, that this tank is connected with another ESR, right? And this ESR or WTP is supplying water to this line. Generally this is not happening. Somewhere here at the WTP we construct UGSR, that is underground storage reservoir, and as well as elevated storage reservoir. Now here this capacity is generally kept 80-20, UG and ESR. Okay, so let us say 150 MLD is to be supplied, right? That is 150 million. Now what is the 80% of that 150 million liters? Find out, calculator, do it, come on first. How much? What is the remaining 20%? That works out to be 120, right? So 120 million liter is the capacity we need to construct by means of UGSR at the treatment plant. Okay, then rest 30 million liters can be contributed by the elevated storage reservoir, that is overhead tank. Here where whatever we are discussing is under the gravitational system of supply. Okay, we are not talking about pumping. if we have pumping mechanism, there we can eliminate this ESR completely. Anyways, we have to pump. So let us pump from directly UGSR itself. No point constructing ESR. Right? So that sort of cost of construction can be optimized at the time when we have to adopt pumping mechanism. Okay. In some of the cases, we may go for combined system. That for part area, gravity will work. And for the remaining part, we will have to pump. So optimization in terms of pumping and gravity systems need to work out at that time. Right? So as soon as this ESR and UGSR are there, this water is supplied to this area wherein it falls under the UGSR of local area. Okay, this line will tell this is the area which is covered by this water supply ESR. Okay, so we have this geographical boundary defined for this area. Right? What do we need? We need to make investigation in terms of area, in terms of HH, in terms of population, in terms of road length. Why? This is for green or cleaning purpose. Maybe we can work out for fire demand. Kuchling's formula is there, right? Kuchling's equation is used generally for calculating the fire demand. For the rest of that, the standards have been defined by CPS EEO. Central Public Health and Environmental Engineering Organization. CPH EEO, which defines the norms or guidelines for further distribution. This is the level, amount of water consumed for the cooking, for the purpose of bathing, for the purpose of washing the clothes, for the purpose of washing the utensils, and so on. Right? So domestic demand for this household is generally how much? 135 liters per capita per day. Now, how many persons in one family will decide the total capacity of tank or local tank that needs to be constructed at a unit level or house level? Okay, that will keep on varying. Let us say my family is of 9 persons, so I need larger tank to be constructed in my house. Let us say your family is of 3 persons, a smaller tank is sufficient. Maybe she has 2 persons, so supply provided by the corporation is sufficient enough to take care of whatever local things are required. You need not to construct any tank at all. Right? So for, let us say, drinking purpose, you have 20 liter storage, fine. One bucket is more than enough. When the fresh water is supplied by the system, you are taking care of washing the clothes, and bathing and cooking, everything. And then you rush for the office. At the end of the day, you are coming back, you all need is some water to get fresh. And some water to do the cooking and the drinking purpose. That's it. And the day is over. So our local storage of maybe 1000 liter is sufficient. Ready-made tanks are also available. In that case, no construction at all is required. Right? So there are a lot of variety of demand at an individual level. But we need to make some justifiable common benchmark which we need to address. Otherwise, the system design will not be possible. Every individual will have a different behavior. Let us say I have a bathtub installed in my house. Maybe I am having 3 bathrooms with bathtubs. Extravaganza usage of water will be required. So I will need to take care of that aspect, and for that I will be constructing a very large tank, underground tank at my home. Right? At the same time, there is a laundry house which will require yet another and higher level of water to be used. It is a professional laundry guy, right? And let us say 10 washing machines has been placed, wherein continuous the washing machines are operated and the clothes are being washed, right? So it will need a continuous supply of water. So So in that case, there is some difference, right? So generalization of this is done by the CPIGEO, and they have determined the amount, how much it should be considered. In this is a purely household. As soon as you are adding road lengths for green area and cleaning and fire demand, the overall demand goes yet higher. Demand means the quantity needed for a person or a household, right? So as soon as we have this idea about the number of household, it is a simple multiplication and we are done, right? So this is added with about 20-25 LPCD. This 135 basic is yet added with 20-25 LPCD when we think about the rest of the aspects. Okay, so somewhere around 155, 160, 170, depending on the type of usage and the population covered. Because the Kuchling's formula, which is carrying out the fire demand, is dependent on P, that is population. It is a rational formula. No scientific proof, but it is based on certain studies. That is how they have derived the constant values in the formula and given an equation of calculating the demand for the purpose of fire. It is not an everyday affair, the fire fighting. Right? It happens once in a year, maybe twice in a year, occasionally at some of the locality, and no one can judge the scale of the fire affected area. Right? So, certain experience-based formula, Kuchling made some study and derived this equation which we directly add up, but it is dependent on what? P, that is population. So larger the population covered under the scheme at the time of calculating demand, the component will be more and this basic will be increased. The smaller one, demand will be less. So 135, 155, you are done with the demand. Okay, so that is how it keeps on working or keep on varying with the change in the proportion of the population, right? But for a single family, a single person, 135 is sufficient, right? For the village area, or for, let us say, some widespread, the locality is having a very low density of population and the housing is scattered for a smaller town. Although even it is an urban area, but the development or housing is what? Scattered. So in that case, what will happen? This demand yet can go lower. So for that, there is need to have an expert judgment about this. How is my locality, for which locality I am working on, what is the culture of the society, right? If there is more of some food habit also may generate larger water demand, right? Say for example, it may happen like the people consuming non-vegetarian food, they need more water compared to one who is adopting vegetarian practice, right? So food habits. So that way there may be some variation. So that sort of things need to be adopted, understand, visualize that what is the culture of the society, and accordingly we need to freeze this amount, that how much should be my individual demand. How much LPCD? Now this LPCD, once available, you straight away multiply it with the number of population that I am serving, and you have a total supply requirement available, right? Now how to derive for a larger and complicated system? Let us say this is a 1, 2, 3 tank serviced area, right? Service area 1, service area 2, service area 3, we have different service area. So whatever geographical boundary, see, when there is a greenfield, no water supply through pipes, we are the king. We can draw these boundaries, simple. For an existing situation where already the pipeline networks are there, we need to identify in what area it is already there. So your case is this one, second one. You have already network established, now you want to simulate it. Yours is the very much similar case, but in some case, a new proposal is required to be given, right? So mixed with both of the case. Fine. So what we have now, that a clear cut identification of geographical spread of the area covered, because you have the supply network lines in front of you, right? That this is the diameter of this line, it is supplying in these lines, it is further bifurcating in this direction with this much length, in this much diameter. You need to work out the demand. So for that, what I suggest is that within this area, how many number of houses are associated to each and every pipe, you obtain that, visualize that. Maybe Google Earth images are useful in this case, right? So with the larger resolution, where the size of pixel is less, but the buildings are visible. Okay, so at certain that appropriate scale, you capture these images and raster it in your as a background image on one layer in the water gems. That is possible. And based on that, you make a judgment. Okay, this is the pipeline on my network which is there. It may be connecting this many number of houses because these pipelines run through the roads. That sort of judgment is possible. Okay, so possible connections. Okay, this pipeline is connecting 12 number of buildings. Okay, under these 12 number of buildings, I have got two low rise apartments, G plus 4, and rest of the 8 are what? Bungalow. Right, so 12 buildings, 2 low rise, and 10 bungalow. Okay. So 2 low rise, how many flats are there? Dwelling unit numbers are, let us say 4 units per floor, G plus 4. So 16 DU in one building, 2 buildings, there are 32 dwelling units. Okay, 13 DU plus 10 DU. How many total DU? 42 dwelling units. 42 dwelling units. Multiplied by average population per family, how much? 5, as per Census of India 2011, the family size, average Indian family size is of 5 persons per family. So, this 42 multiplied by 5, how many? 210, remember? So, 210 persons will generate what demand? So 210 multiplied by 135 or 155, whatever you have worked out. So that is the quantity of water need to be reached to this pipe. So for allowing that quantity of water at the end of this pipe, let us say what amount we derived? 210 liters. 42 by 150. Is 6300 liter.
32 multiplied by 150 is 6300 liter. 42 multiplied by 5. 42 10. Why 2 multiplied by 42? 42 is the dwelling unit population. Is 210. So it's 31,500. 31,500. 500. 500. Liters.
Not. Now we have no LPCD. We are in liters. And if you convert it into ml, it is 0.315 million liters. Not 0.315, 0.0315 million liters. 10 lakhs, a million. Right? 0.0315 ml is the demand at the end of this pipe. Similarly, you identify at the end of this pipe, this pipe, this pipe, this pipe, all the pipes. Now here, let us say you have worked out A, here you have worked out B, here you have worked out C. So as soon as your network is this much of land, at this point you need A, but as soon as you come to this point, you have A plus B. Okay, that will run up to where? Here. Here we have C. So here C, here A plus B, but at this point we have A plus B plus C. That will be okay till here. Similarly, that way from every smallest or the end, the demands will be moving up, up, up. And the amount of water will be increasing. Okay. So in a reverse calculation, when you are arriving at the first tank, right, the last point, that is ESR. So that will tell you what should be the capacity of this ESR. But when we are arriving at ESR, add for supply losses about 15%. Generally that is happening, that somewhere some leakage is going on, some system components are not working 100% efficiently. Some pipe diameter is reduced because of certain congestion, right? So that sort of thing may happen in the system. So 15% reduction is observed. So what you have worked out is the net demand, pure. But it is not going to be reaching because it will account for certain losses. So the assumption well in advance for the losses will be allowing you to supply the water actually which is required. Otherwise, whatever you are assuming here, the 15% less water will be reaching. And the people will start generating hue and cry. The water is not available sufficiently. Right? So what you have questioned your respondent, whether the quantity of water is available in appropriateness or not. Right? So the issue of sort of thing comes from this calculation. Whether the system is designed accordingly or not, that we need to think of first. Right? So, even let us assume that the system is working fantastically and the losses are not at par with 15% that we were assuming. Then people will get somewhat extra water. What is wrong with that? Right? Or you may store that water for tomorrow's supply, which will ultimately help you in optimizing the treatment of water, which will back in reverse will help you in optimizing the requirement fetching from the source. Because from here to here you have been incurring expenditure of fetching everyday water. I am not talking about capital investment. Even though the system is laid with a higher capacity, you can always run it to a lower capacity depending on the requirement in the market. But still, we design it for the peak. Why? Because it must not fail in the peak hours. It must not fail when the people is actually needing this water. So we design considering that. Now how much is to be supplied? It is always in our hand. Or the one who is administering the system managers are meant for this job, right? So as soon as this is done, this system keeps on working. Now when we talk about the supply from this local ESR, let us say there are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 mains moving away from this line, right? So here we'll have to put certain barrier when I am running one ESR pipe coming to downward. We have 5 different ends moving in 5 different directions. Or it may go like one pipe is coming out to up to certain area and from there are 5 different pipes. What kind of system is that? We need to understand in the case of existing one. Or when we are designing, we'll need to make an assumption for design. So here, when we are taking this, understanding this thing, we'll need to control the supply in each of the pipe, as we are not 24/7 system. If it is 24/7 system, all what we need is to just keep on pumping from ESR. Put some sensors in the ESR, which will keep us telling about the level of water in the ESR, and accordingly it will keep on running and shutting down the pump, which is pumping water from UGSR to ESR constantly, depending on the usage in the system, right? If not, will need to make a control over all these lines. So control valves are placed. Okay, and these control valves are placed everywhere, almost everywhere in the system. Why? Because we need to make sure that any moment of time when there is one pipe ruptured or when there is a breakage, entire system must not hamper. It must not happen like that, right? So as soon as I have some error in this part of area, I will shut this line from here. So the minimum area is suffering of the non-servicing. By the time I am repairing it, the other part of the system is not suffering, right? Otherwise, what could have happened? I must have placed only one valve here. If it is the case, the disturbance here would be disturbing entire supply of this branch or main. It must not happen like that. So there are a lot of valves in the system, which generally are kept open when the normal supply is there. But at the time of system failure, when certain parts are broken, we need to close it, right? Otherwise, when, let us say, I want to supply water of this much quantity in this line, entire line, so what I need to do is that open the valve at a particular time. This one valve I will open, the water will flow through gravity into this entire system. And the duration that may be worked out, because this liter of quantity needs to be delivered at the end. Now you determine in what time it should be delivered. So as soon as you determine, you work it out as, let us say, 2 hours or 1 hour and 50 minutes or 1 hour 40 minutes. So in a judgment you take that, okay, this much water can be supplied in a 2 hours duration. Okay, so based on that 2 hours, what we are doing further? We are extracting or assuming the Q at the end, discharge, meter cube per second. Okay, so as soon as 2 hours, at the end of 2 hours, I must get this much amount of water at this end. So simple, these liters are converted into meter cube. 1000 liter is 1 meter cube. Okay, 1000 liter is 1 meter cube. And 2 hours, so let us make division by 120 seconds. So meter cube per second Q is available. So Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, Q5, Q6, Q7, and so on. Every pipe that you have entered with certain number, you will have that many number of Qs, generated demands at the end, which will be kept on accumulated. And cumulative demand is worked out here, which will be telling you the Q required here at the ESR. Now as soon as you have Q of each and every section, you put it in the formula of head loss, energy equations will come into the picture, right? HF has a formula, right? The rating curves are given with diameters and the discharge relationships are given along with the frictional losses that will incur. A ready-made wedge-based formula can be used, Darcy's formula can be used, right? So either way, you assume a diameter, verify the discharge, or determine the diameter, similar process, right? Vice versa. Any of these things is available with us, we can design the entire of the system. The function of these valves, whether you call it a flange valve or this valve or that valve, the basic function of any valve is to control the flow. The water must flow when you want it to flow in the system, right? Except for certain cases, there are one-way valves or two-way valves, there are some other stories. Different functionality is required in some special cases, and for that some kind of valves are also evolved, a variety of valves. Otherwise the function remains the same, right? You may go for a butterfly valve. What does it do? It opens or shuts. Now, because of its size and shape, the component of friction loss is somewhat different. and because of that, the effect of that shape on the supply will be different. So Q varies when water passes through this particular shape to a minor, to a smaller extent, right? But the more number of such valves will slow down the flow, correct? So that sort of calculations are performed when the type of valve you have defined, okay? So that doesn't make much difference actually when we are talking about new system. You think of the valve which has got less friction component. Friction factor must be lowest, right? At the same time, you also think of the cost of such valve. The only function is to control the flow. That is it. Okay? So this is how it works. I think it is enough. Clear? Still any questions, Prashant?
There's a valve opening and
closing.
How we means,
how to come to that part?
Yeah.
That for how much duration the valve should be open so that water is flowing. That is what I told, no? We have this demand at the end. Now you determine how much time you want to supply that water.
That is already.
See, we got when you make a judgment that this water I am supposed to deliver in 24 hours. So there will be 24 divisions of this very figure. Okay, how much that is? Calculate. Let us say 31500 divided by 24.
Seven eight seven five liter,
and divide it by 2.
Seven five zero liters.
Now let us make a division of this in terms of seconds. And then convert it to the meter cube. So as soon as you are deriving at a Q, what will happen? The size of pipe installed or required to be installed is very smaller diameter at the end, right? But at the same time, the smaller diameter will result into what? Maximization of losses. Are you getting the point? Correct? So, supply the water for 2 hours. You have got sufficient diameter of pipe. Now this 2 hours, 3 hours, 1 hour, half an hour, that is a decision made by the authority or the designer of the system. People would like to have 24/7, but while you are creating the system 24/7, your diameters are smaller in size, you are consuming more of energy, because the system will consume more energy in form of frictional losses. The effective supply will be less compared to what you can get at an expense of consumption of energy. Let us say kilowatt of hours consumed in terms of energy for pushing water from UGSR to ESR, this cycle will keep on running more if you are going with 24/7. Okay, so that way it is also possible to provide, no problem with that, right? But for that, this sort of calculations will come into the picture. You must make a justification whether the system will work appropriately or not. Before that, we need to make sure why this system is not accepted. 2 hour supply, why people want 24/7? What is the funda in that? Fundamental is what? You need to make a justification of it. Is the actual demand 24/7 is there or not? Whether people really want, if they want, why do they want? Right? Are we assuming by providing 24/7 to remove individual water tanks from entire area. Do you want to help citizens to develop their mass houses or houses in that fashion? If your answer is yes, you can go with that 24/7 scheme. In any ways, people are going to construct the tanks for their safety concerns of available water supply. If they are going to construct, they will definitely construct as per the demand. All what you need to take care of is to supply the water as per the demand. That's it. Whether you supply it in one hour or 2 hours or 3 hours, who cares? So depending on that decision, the operating is determined. Whether I will open this valve for 2 hours or 1 hour, this decision is related with the time in which this much supply is to be ensured.
Pressure.
Now that pressure is the component related directly with the Q and diameter of pipe. Okay, so deriving the Q, you have this Q. Okay, you assume some area of pipe and make an iteration. It is an iterative cycle. Your target is to deliver Q at the end in a desired time duration. So automatically the losses will be coming into the picture, right? You go with Q and assume diameter, and whether your system design is able to draw water at the end which is required. If not, you change it. What is pressure? What is pressure? How do you visualize pressure? When there is no, in a very layman's term, I tell you that if the water is not delivered at a certain pressure level, the quantity that is available is less. Your citizens, your clients are going to tell this much only. They are not going to talk to you in the language of Pascal, kilonewton per mm square or newton per mm square or any other unit. They will only tell, hey sir, we receive only 2 buckets in 1 hour duration of supply. Or they can tell you, sir, I can get 10 buckets filled in a duration of 1 hour. No one is caring about the pressure. What at the end matters is the quantity supplied. It will keep on varying depending on the diameter that we are using in the system. Larger diameter, pressure will be there. Something smaller diameter, different pressure. Right? But there is certainly a relationship between Q and P, but that is related with the A. Diameter will decide for a particular quantity supply how much pressure is required. This equation when is changed, the result will be problematic. It is a customized term. We cannot make a fix, this is a house, so this much pressure must be received. It depends on the entire system in background. How much diameter of pipeline is employed for the job of drawing water from USR, ESR to the end user. At the end, this much pressure must be received. But for what time the duration supply is set? How much quantity is required to be supplied? Right? You can make assurance that let us take or tap the water for particular quantity. Let us say I am filling up 1 bucket. Okay, the capacity of this bucket is known, 20 liters. Okay, so as soon as I am fully on, putting the tap full on and allowing the water to flow into the bucket, it is filled up to 20 liters marking you have made. Right? How many seconds? Okay, 3 seconds it is filled. 10 seconds it is filled. So 10 seconds, 20 liters, 20 divided by 10, make conversion, bring it to Q, meter cube per second.
You have the diameter in front of you. What is the pressure? Identify. For this quantity, 20 liters per this second or meter cube per second. So this supply is continued for 2 hours. Yes, 2 hours. So what is the total quantity supplied? This much. Okay. How many number of people residing in this house? 10 persons. Okay. Whether it is sufficient for 10 persons or not, you make a decision, make a judgment. Now, to overcome this, what you would like to do? Whether I will go with increase of supply duration or increasing or reducing the diameter of the pipeline. What is easier? Easier is to keep the valve open for more time, if it is the case, or less time, if it is the case. So it is a, you know, jugglery of judgments, jugglery of equations. It is a mess of equations, actually. But at the end, it is very simple, like this only. It goes, you know, very uniform fundamental. Very simple that we have understood till now. It works on that fundamental only. But the number of these judgments is quite iterative. Lot of them. Larger. Network is always cumbersome. Because the urban areas are highly dense, widely, mostly populated area. Every individual house will need to be given one connection. So the system itself making it a complex in terms of behavior, the requirement and network becomes complex in turn to respond to that system. If you have 5 houses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, what is needed? One tank, one pipe, one pipe, one pipe, one pipe, that's all. Keep the valve open 24/7. Who cares? There are 5 houses at all. I have got 10,000 liter tank in front of me. I have got a bore well. I am fetching water from ground. Anytime when I want, the ESR is empty, I'll switch on the bore, the water will be filled in, I'll start using. Very convenient. But it is not the case when we deal about the urban area. So whenever the additional quantity is required, in any way the household or the people are going to employ the second source, that is underground source. Shallow or deep, whichever well they will construct jack wells or bore wells, whatever. By any means, they are going to fulfill their demands at extra costs as well. When the system is not able to supply the sufficient quantity of water that is available. But for that, we need to make a check on the yield of the source as well. If the yield is not allowing to supply 155 LPCD, what one can do? We cannot do anything. We can have a design which is able to supply desired level of water at 155 LPCD, but the yield is not availing you that much amount of water. The source is not allowing you to use that much water. Let us say 150 ml you have worked out the requirement, and your source yield is how much? 70 million liters per day into 365. Million liters, that is the amount what you can get. So the system designed at 155 will not allow you to supply water at 155 ml. That will be reduced to the source is allowing you. But anyways, we must make a system design considering this aspect and not the source, because at any moment of time we can have addition of or alteration or augmentation of the source, increasing the capacity by different means. If we are fetching water from the ground, we can make a ruling that each and every household must go for groundwater recharge. Construct it, maintain it regularly, compulsion. So that will automatically recharge your groundwater level. The levels will be higher. And you can install some capacity of jack wells, deep bore wells, from where you can improve the intake. Your source is augmented. Now that water you can flush into the water treatment plant, and through this already established network you start supplying. People are happy. So depending on the type of problem that is actually existing, we need to make customized solution. There cannot be uniform solution to every situation. Nevertheless, it can not be a solution like that in any of the problems. Everywhere we need customization. Anything else? That is it? Okay. Thank you.